Good evening. Thank you very much for all those introductions. You've said most of what I was going to say already, so I'll try and come up with some new stuff. I just want to say I was 99 on that 100 list at Wired, so take that CEO of Spotify. As you've heard, I wear many hats. I operate as an artist, a writer, a journalist, and a number of other things as the opportunity comes, essentially. I'm never sure which one I'm speaking as when I'm speaking. But when I speak, I will speak through the medium of some of the things that I've made, which is not to be too big-headed about them. I don't just want to go, look at all these amazing things I've made. But I make them as props. I make them as part of my process of understanding things. I largely become fascinated, over-fascinated, obsessed with things, go way too deep into them, and try to figure them out in a way that I understand them myself. And as a product of that, I may write an essay, or I may make an artwork, or I may do any particular thing as a way of coming to understand it. So I will show some things I've made and tell you some things that I've thought, and hopefully they're interesting and perhaps even useful to you. So let's start with these. Has anyone seen these? Thank you, please put their hand. These are, I call these the rainbow planes, right? If you spend as much time as I do crawling through Google Maps, or other online satellite maps are available, you will occasionally come across these strange, slightly odd-looking images. They're images of planes, they're real planes in flight. But they're artifacts of satellite mapping. They're planes that have been captured in flight by the vision systems of satellites. And in that sense, you know, presented to us like this, as they're beautiful to me, at least. They're also mistakes, they're glitches. But like all true glitches, they kind of allow us to see underneath into the underlying system that's producing this material. In this case, satellite imagery, but in a larger sense, all the technologies and systems that are producing the world around us and that we inhabit. Rainbow planes are caused by the fact that satellites, imaging satellites, they don't use a camera, a regular camera like we might use, that's basically analogous to the human eye. You know, a visible light comes in and you process it and it comes out as a kind of singular image. Rather, satellite images use a thing called a multispectral sensor, which means they have an electromagnetic sensor, or several of them, that go across the human vision spectrum, but they also go deep into the infrared and into the ultraviolet. They can sense in wavelengths that we're not capable of perceiving. And they take those as separate images. And so when those images are combined, you get images that look like this, where the red, green, and blue images are taken at slightly different levels, and even a higher definition black and white image. And when those satellites are moving very fast, and the planes are moving very fast, it produces this as a glitch of the system. But in that glitch, we can understand how this image was created. We can see how the satellites see. So I make things like this to kind of help us to understand these things. This is a one-to-one replica of a rainbow plane drawn onto the ground as a way of, you know, talking and showing about how these systems work. But it's also a particular plane. It's a Gulfstream 5 private jet, the preferred transport of billionaires and also the CIA's torture program. Because if you want a good life hack and how to cross borders, the best way to do it is to be very, very rich and powerful. My belief is that by outlining and drawing these technological systems, by sketching them out, by kind of throwing paint over them like you would do over the Invisible Man, we can actually start to understand a huge amount about the power structures that produce them and our own place in them as well. And I do this in various ways. We've already heard about the drone shadows, which are a series of outlines of military drones, same approach, one-to-one outlines of these things in the city streets. Turned out to be fairly powerful. I did one purely, again, kind of for myself the first time, in order to understand this thing, because I was really fascinated by these flying killer robots. But I knew I'd never, like, stand in front of them and approach one myself, and I would not be able to measure myself against one. A huge part of this work is simply making a thing physical, because basically we have really dumb lizard brains that really struggle to conceptualize some of this kind of the kind of intangible questions of technology. of being able to, no one can hold the whole network or whole internet in their heads, right? We need metaphors and descriptions to carry this across. So you sketch it out, you get a can of paint and you draw the thing. And immediately a whole bunch of things become clear. The first thing that people always say on seeing the drone shadows is like, I had no idea it was so big. Which is a totally rational and also totally banal response. But it produces further questions. Like, this thing I've heard about so much, I didn't even know how big it was. How did I miss that about it? And then when you get through that, you start to think of a whole bunch of other stuff about it. My first thought was how making this thing visible in this way serves to emphasize its invisibility. Not just its physical invisibility, designed to fly at, you know, 50,000 feet to be out of the range of human sight, but as already been mentioned, its moral invisibility, its ethical invisibility. This is a technology that's designed to take advantage of not just physical effects, but moral ones as well. And in a wider sense too, for me, the drones are, they're kind of avatars of the network. And I keep using this word network, and I'll keep using it. And when I say network, I mean like the internet and us, all network technologies and us, as a complete system with which we're enmeshed, and really can't like pretend anymore that we're somehow separate from, again, either physically or morally. It's part of a network that we use every day, but it's a part of the network that's kind of attuned to secrecy, to invisibility, and ultimately, as often comes with those effects, violence and death. Likewise, in a project called Dronestagram, I upload images of the sites of illegal covert drone strikes in as part of undeclared wars to Instagram, and a photo sharing network that many of us use every day. Because, again, these are parts of the same network. They run on essentially the same substrate. The GPS in your phone that you may well have used to look up an online map, or even the map itself to guide you here this evening, is the same technology that guides these bombers to their targets. The same ability to see and act at a distance that afforded to us by consumer technologies and apps is the same technologies and affect that's driving these kind of wars. All I'm doing in these works is kind of closing the circle between those things, again, in order to understand them, to understand our place in them. I'll talk more specifically or more in depth about a particular project that attempts to do this. Back in November of 2013, a particular story in the papers in the UK caught my eye. And this was a story of a guy called Isamuwaza, who was a Nigerian citizen, had been in the UK for over 10 years, who was being deported. And he went on hunger strike, and he tried to prevent his deportation. And he was ultimately placed aboard a private jet, that thing again, they keep cropping up, and flown out of the country under the personal orders of the British Home Secretary. And this kind of weird thing occurred where the Nigerian airspace didn't let the plane in, and it was diverted. And eventually returned to the UK almost 24 hours later. But the bit of the story that jumped out at me was private jet, I'm sorry. We're deporting people on Gulfstream jets now. And it turns out that is a thing that my country does, and other countries in Europe do as well. But what I was particularly fascinated in this story was that there was very little detail about this process. But I also knew that I had the technology and the knowledge and the skills at my disposal to find out significantly more about it than was presented to me in the various news stories that I read about it. And so the first thing I did was I started going to Planespotters websites. Planespotters are brilliant, right? They stand at airports all over the world and they take the notes of what planes are flying in and out of it, and they put them all online and they talk to each other. And they don't really like talking to nosy people like me because really they're just into planes, but they put this information out there. And so I found the website of a plane spotter in Malta, which is where the plane was being diverted to. And on his website, he listed the tail number of a private jet that had turned up at the airport in Malta that day. So I could plug that information into a website called Flight Radar 24, which tracks the movements of planes. That animation you saw right at the start of this program is the animation of all flights over Europe about a month ago. But all the planes, because we have open data and because we have open network systems, they have a beacon inside them that transmits and shows their position, and someone can take that position and put it on the web. And so I can find not only that flight, but I can find the plane. I can find who owns that plane. I can find the company that does it, and I can go, that's kind of interesting that plane is part owned by a UK football manager, which it turned out it was. But it's part of a company, it becomes part of a network, it becomes part of a system that you can start to approach and understand. And because this is what I do, I wrote that up and I put it on a blog post and talked about it a bit. And I got a phone call from an activist group, some people who work very directly in trying to prevent deportation flights. And they said, that was really interesting, thanks, we didn't know about this company and this plane, and that's something we can add to our information, because what we do is we go out and we protest those particular companies that are involved in this system to try and stop them working with the government to deport people. And they said, well, that was really interesting what you did. We know about one that's leaving next week, and can you tell us something about that? And I was like, no, I don't know magic. Like, I can't look into the future and tell you how it's going to work next week. And then I realized I could figure it out. I could approach it. Because through my researches, I knew where the flights go from. Which is actually a private terminal at London's Stansted Airport, which is one of the airports just outside London. And on one side is all the big terminals where everyone goes on their holidays from, and on the other side is the private terminal for the private jets, where during the daytime it's business people and celebrities and footballers, and in the middle of the night it's used for deporting people. And so I figured, well, if I know what night it's going, I might as well go there. And this is that weird moment when playing around with the computer and Googling stuff and reading Wikipedia trips over into seeing a little bit more of the world than you're used to. And so I end up at Stansted Airport in the middle of the night watching the deportations happen. And whatever, and I think I'm probably among friends here, but don't always speak to sympathetic audiences on these subjects, whatever you may think of deportation systems, of the detention systems, of the way all kinds of people who fall foul of the law are treated, watching people being loaded off buses in handcuffs in the middle of the night looks wrong, right? And you know something must be going fundamentally wrong when this is the way in which we're behaving and this is the way our society is operating. So I got the plane and I figured out which one it was, and I poked my camera through the fence, and then I got told off by the police. And but it's fine. I could go back to the activist group, and I could tell them where this plane was going, and they could, again, add this plane to their database, and I can also add it to my database. And now I have a complete database of all the flights of this plane, as well as taking people on holiday. I actually found out a mate of mine, a couple of years ago, went on holiday on this same plane, because it gets chartered to anyone. But I notice occasionally, or actually twice a month, when it flies to Lagos, or to Azerbaijan, or to Pakistan, that's not a charter holiday flight. That's something else. And you can start to piece together the thing that the government won't tell you anything about. But I wanted to look kind of further inside some of these places. I didn't always want to be poking my camera through a chain link fence at 3 o'clock in the morning. But I knew there was very little way of getting access to these things. But again, I know about technology. I have certain odd skills about this kind of stuff. And I know these places exist, right? This is Harmondsworth Detention Centre, an immigration detention centre just outside London, next to Heathrow Airport, where people who have either just arrived and have been detained or are awaiting deportation are kept, often indefinitely, effectively. And you know, if Google Earth can see it, if satellites can see it from space, I must be able to have some way of seeing it. I believe in our new technologies, as scary and dystopian as they can often be, as useful tools of inquiry. Things that we didn't know before must be knowable to us through these technologies in ways that they were not knowable before. A quick side note to explain why I took the approach I'm about to take. This is a thing that I've been fascinated in for a while. The new aesthetic, which was mentioned before, is not and was never just about images. Right? It was about how they were produced and the roles that they play in the world, and also all the other things that are not images, like texts and discourses and objects, and how they are kind of formed through networks, and you know, can talk for a long time. But one of the things I would be fixated in that project was architectural visualization. Right? When you're walking around a city and you see a huge building site, and you see this picture on the front of it that's been made by a computer, that the building will never look like this, right? The building never really looked like this. The building is always kind of an assemblage of constructors and developers and architects and engineers and all this kind of stuff. And also, it will never look like this. But this is the image of it that operates in the world, right? This is the image that got it through planning. This is the image that they showed to the planning department and they showed to the people who pay for it, and that made this huge physical thing possible. And so that image, the CGI visualization of the built environment, stands in for kind of everything that is not the built environment itself. And it's produced by software, right? It's produced by all these different kinds of software. And architects get very annoyed at me, and many of my best friends are architects, when I say to them that I think like the guy who designed AutoCAD in an office in Northern California has as much to do with the shape of the built environment as most architects. But I think it's entirely true. I've met, civil engineers rather than architects, because architects are too proud to say this, who claim that they can look at a building and tell me not just what software package it was designed in, but what version of that software. Right? There are tolerances and shapes and windowsill depths and basically drop-down defaults that define certain things. And if you know both sides of that practice, you can see it. An architectural visualizer told me my favorite phrase from this, which is lorem ipsum architecture, where he describes when he's given like a kind of vague plan by an architect, and he goes into his like folder of furniture objects and fills in a street with things that look roughly like benches, and behold, they become real in the world because they're just the little details they didn't really think about, but they're in the image, so stick them in, right? This is how the world becomes in huge parts of it, because increasingly this stuff is systematized. But you can read kind of deeper and more purposeful political intent into these things as well. This is an image, I've recorded hundreds of these images, by the way. These are all photos I've taken of billboards wherever. But this one was near my house in London, which is astonishing because it's not, I live in a reasonably nice bit. This is definitely not one of the nicer bits where this image was taken, but it's being heavily redeveloped. And in this image, you can see the exact moment of gentrification being kind of encoded into the space, where these lovely BMW and the 4x4 have been artfully placed in front of the actual, because this is an actual photo of the street that has then been edited with the building coming up on your right. New growth trees has been placed in the end. Someone in a nice shirt and on the phone, as sort of business person, has been placed in, while an actual local inhabitant in a football shirt kind of absolutely blurs slowly out of existence in this vision. So if you stare at these images and really pay attention to them, they tell you so much more about the space than purely what they're absolutely intended to transmit. But they can also be kind of beautiful and powerful as digital artworks or any kind of image making can be. This is an image by a London architectural studio called Pictureplane, which takes its sky and its colour palette from 19th century landscape painting. I liked it so much that I worked with them on this project. Which was, as I said, trying to see inside these buildings, to visualize them, so that you can talk about them, so that you can hold them in your mind and therefore discuss and critique them. So I researched the architecture of these spaces. I went to the planning office and got the original planning applications for these buildings, which were, of course, available from your local government because yay, transparency. Unphotographable. They're nevertheless very well documented in these kind of official documents. And some of the process is visible as well. You can't photograph courtrooms in the UK, but you can go in part to the actual court cases themselves, and I'm fairly sure it's the same case here. I advise you to go to courtrooms if you've never been. The judicial process is fascinating and up close, and often, you know, reasonably heartening. Not so much this place, which is the Special Immigration Appeals Committee in the UK. Which hears immigration cases that relate to intelligence in some way. So they passed a special law which says they can hold hearings which use secret evidence so that the defendant and the legal team are not told what the evidence against a person is. As a result of this court has open and closed sessions. So you can go in at some times, you can hear some of the procedures, and other times the door is closed. The process happens completely in secret, again with the defendant and their legal team in another room. But you can't photograph in there, but you can sketch, particularly when you take tame architects along. So we took these designs of these places and we put them into the CGI programs that the architectural visualizers use. We built up these places as best we could from these plans. And the same technique that's usually used to sell developments and luxury flats, we redeployed it. Kind of not to commercialise, but to critique, and not of imaginary places, but of very real ones. So this is Field House, which is the building in which the Special Immigration Appeals Committee takes place, and this is that courtroom. Remember, the thing about the secret evidence, right? It is manifest in the architecture of this space itself. You can critique these places in various ways, but you can see the point at which that law becomes the built environment, becomes the architecture that surrounds you. So this courtroom has a sealed-off witness box with curtains so that the spooks can give their evidence without becoming visible to the courtroom. And it has a partition here so that other observers can be present in the courtroom without being seen from the public gallery, which is where this comes from. And so the technology allowed us to represent a reality which I don't have access to. I was on the other side of this fence poking through, all right? And also to counter the images of these places that are presented to us. If you go onto the website of the in-flight jet center, this private jet terminal, you don't see it at night in the rain with coach loads and security guards in hybrid jackets, right? We can change the presentation of these places. And I'm kind of trying to represent something wider here as well, because this film isn't about... And this is a kind of 8-minute looping film, a tour of these various locations. This is not obviously its entirety. But this film isn't about the individual stories of kind of detainees and migrants themselves, as necessary and crucial as those stories are. But it's about the unaccountability and ungraspability of the vaster, wider system around it. The architecture and what the architecture stands in for, which is all of the legal and social processes behind it. These kind of accumulations of law and pressure and public opinion, the infrastructures of intent and prejudice that shape all of this, right? I'm not trying to document individual experiences, I'm trying to draw a picture of the whole thing, the whole network in one person's head. How do you draw a picture of all of that now, knowing what we know? And I think through some of these approaches, through investigation, through journalism, through codes, and through these new technologies, we have this opportunity to show and describe these places in ways that hasn't been possible before. Let's look at another case, another really cheery case, I apologize, in advance. This is a guy called Mohammed Saka. He was born in 1985 in London, a few miles from where I live, and his parents were Egyptian immigrants to the UK. And citizens of the UK, as obviously was Mohammed, having been born and grown up there, and been to school in London and everything else. He did some things, and we're not sure what they are, and I'm sure we would not have been necessarily friends. But I'm also reasonably sure that he was a citizen of my country and grew up in my city. In September of 2010, while he was out of the country, his parents received this letter from the British government. On behalf of the Home Secretary, saying that they had deprived him of his citizenship, which is a UK legal term for when they literally remove your citizenship, your status in the world. He didn't possess any other citizenship, and I won't go into the niceties of why that was legally possible and so on and so forth, but it was. He was disowned by the British government while out of the country. 18 months later, he was killed by a US drone strike in Somalia. Hannah Arendt said that the citizenship is the right to have rights. It's the roof over all of us that kind of allows us certain protections. And in this case, it was summarily withdrawn by the British government without, you know, full legal due process at the discretion of the Home Secretary. And the result of that is death. If you do not have the protections of citizenship now in the world, then this is what can happen to you. And this, again, is one of those things that was naively, initially, horrifically shocking to me, that this can be done in this way, that citizenship, something that most of us are lucky enough to see as very central and very secure, is something that can be removed, that can be changed. But of course it can, because law itself is not something that is fixed. There's this lovely code that some of us like to use these days, that code is law, that technology kind of produces the world in these very concrete ways, which is a dangerous formulation because the law is not law. The law, in fact, is more like code. This is one kind of aspect of, you can imagine as a kind of huge spider diagram of different pieces of legislation that all come together to permit the, the death of Mohammed Saka, from various pieces of UK legislation that define nationality, citizenship, even define the nation itself, through to the authorization of military force in the US, which permits drone strikes, and various military and civil cases that have kind of allowed that program to happen. All of these are competing programs, and they're also ones that are being constantly rewritten and kind of redirected in different ways. The only thing that's kind of shaping these things is the interests that direct them. But again, as a technologist, something actually comes at me that allows me to understand this because I see it as a changelog, and I know what those are, right? I know how you rewrite code and refactor it and change it. These are useful skills to have in trying to understand how these things actually operate. And code is not a manifestation of law, it's something that we've developed, as all our technologies, things that we've developed, to explain not what the world might be always, but actually often what it is right now, as new metaphors for understanding it. This for me is the reality of these powers as they are now. We can read them really successfully, but we're not so sure if we can write them. Most of the time they're being dictated to us. I'm sure you've seen holograms like this at kind of airports or railway stations. They're terrifying bloody things. Well, this is one that tells you what your rights are as a citizen and how you can be killed, which is what I ended up turning that changelog, that list, into. You expect to see more of these things around the world. And I use this form because for me it alludes to the border. It alludes to that point of transit, that point of change, at which all of these things, all of these issues, come into incredibly sharp focus as moments at which we're both, either incredibly lucky or incredibly vulnerable. So let's talk about borders for a minute. Because borders are another of those things that aren't fixed and secure. They're not easy or well-defined in any way. This is one of my favorite examples, which is the border at Ceuta in the border of Spain and Morocco, who have a land border at these couple of strange little ports they dug out of the North African coast, and where on one side you can be a happy Spanish golf player, on the other side you can be perched across the fence waiting to drop at your moment. We're seeing a lot of pictures like this at the moment. These borders are proliferating. We seem to live in a time of intense physical wall building. This is the Israeli-Palestinian separation wall, which runs through one of these kind of crucibles of the exportation of these kind of military technologies or social technologies. There's innovation zones for this kind of stuff as well. The US-Mexico border, the border between Hungary and Serbia, which is obviously very much in use today, or the Evros River border between Turkey and Greece, right? This is a border that is actually, you know, not stopping people in any meaningful way, it's rather pushing them very directly into ever more dangerous places. The walls, like most of the rules, they don't stop things, they merely rechannel it. And if we don't, you know, catch some of those exceptions, we end up with ever worse disasters. This is my favourite wall. This is the UK's national barrier asset. We built this, my government built this. We built it for a NATO summit, and then we used it to surround the Olympics. And now we've sent it to France, because we've got miles of it, and we can put it wherever we like. Which is usually France. This is one that I came across myself. This was an anti-austerity process in London. This is in the middle of Trafalgar Square, for those who don't know, it's like the centre of the city, which is bisected by this insane steel walls with like actual gun slits in it, which looks like this from the back, which is literally a truck that kind of folds out into these fences. And then later on that night, this was what was used to communicate with people inside the kettle. I'm assuming you have kettles here as well. When people are hemmed in by the police, they then rolled up one of these things, which is an LCD screen on the front and a huge klaxon on the top, to address the people who were hemmed in by the police in the kettle. But what intrigued me most was on the side of it had a serial number, which starts with CBRN, which stands for Chemical, Biological, Radiation and Nuclear. Right. This was an emergency tool. This has been given to the police to deal with the kind of widespread social fallout you might expect in the following a kind of major civil disaster scenario, right? Which one might argue is how the austerity program is currently manifesting and being responded to. These are all ways in which these technologies we build in one place, whether it's the walls or whether it's machines like this or whether it's the technologies themselves, take on other aspects. And when they take on those aspects, they freight with them the politics of the place in which they're invented. So borders aren't just deployed physically, or borders aren't just on the ground, and they aren't just deployed physically where we need them any one time, they're also deployed through policy and law. Frontex, the European border agency, refers to the entire of the Middle East and North Africa as the common pre-frontier, is their term for it, right? The border is actually a huge, vast, distributed zone, hundreds or even thousands of miles beyond the border itself. Likewise, in the US, the 100-mile border zone is the area in which US border forces are permitted to operate, by which I mean the laws that apply to the border force when they search people at a border can be used by the border force up to 100 miles inland, which is where two-thirds of the population actually live. So two-thirds of the population of the US are technically living within the border zone. And the border zone is, of course, extended through these technologies. So the drones, of which we hear so much, again, weapon systems developed for very specific types of warfare, right? For warfare amongst civilian populations in heavily crowded areas, asymmetric wars, unclear, undecided, and often undeclared wars, are now being deployed across the Mediterranean to look for refugee boats. These are this transference of intent tells us, you know, plenty. Or the hologram that I showed you before, because these things don't always look like the technologies of war, right? This is the hologram developed at the University of Arizona for interrogating people at the border. So this hologram speaks to people at the border and is capable of reading skin temperature, pupil response, these kind of things, in order to tell whether or not someone is lying. But this is a technology that was developed to interrogate people at the US-Mexico border and to look for drug traffickers, where it's now being deployed at the EU border. It's being trialled in Romania and Hungary, because the threat is non-specific, like with the austerity protests. One identified threat can be encoded into a technology and then deployed somewhere else. I'm speeding up because I'm running on a little too long, but I have one more thing to show you properly. I want to say, so when this is embedded into certain kinds of technologies, it's not just embedded into like the object or the piece of code itself, but embodied into the ways in which we use these, like Dronestagram being a social media, a place in which you share photos of your daily life being given over to showing you the reality of perhaps someone else's thing. This is US customs boats, which is used to intercept migrants at sea, where they're then interviewed by teleconference. Right. So that people are brought up onto the boat and their nationality is determined within international waters by using the technologies of teleconferencing. And using that, the information gained in that, to make determinations upon them based on what someone has when they're pulled out of the sea, which might simply be their voice and their claims they've made. And this is a work by my friend, the artist Lawrence Abraham, who's in part one of Forensic Architecture, whom you heard, who's done this is a work called The Freedom of Speech Itself. One of the techniques used by the Australians and by many European countries to determine someone's citizenship is their accent. They're put on the phone with someone who is supposedly an expert in regional accents, and that is used to determine the validity of their claim. He actually went to court in the UK for someone who'd been refused asylum because while they claimed to be Palestinian, the vocal expert said that they were in fact Lebanese, which does not get you refugee status under our system. And in fact had narrowed this down to a single phoneme, to the may in the, or ma in the middle of the word tomato. The way in which that word was spoken changed this person's status above and beyond any particular piece of paper that they held. The thing is, when nationality can be determined at all those levels, and when these forms of nationality and this border space has become totally ubiquitous, that's happening to all of us all of the time, not just these edge cases, not just these people you hear about on the border, but all of us all the time. Historically, there have been like two main ways of working out your citizenship. And those things are called jus sanguinis and jus soli. Jus sanguinis is the right of the blood. Right? Your citizenship is determined by who your parents are and what citizenship they hold and how strong a hold on that citizenship they have. But it comes through the blood. And that's the system that holds in most of Europe. Soli is the right of the soil, the right of the ground. So it's the ground that you're born upon. If you're born in that place, you are a citizen of that place. Which I put up this diagram purely because it's interesting to me that that's actually what it holds in what we might once call the New World. That's the main American way of judging citizenship. And Europe and other places tend to go largely by jus sanguinis, the right of the blood. But of course, we're not always there present to give blood or give soil or to attest to our family when our citizenship is judged. Our citizenship is being judged all the time. Whenever you open a web page and you get shown a bunch of adverts, or you Google or go to some website that needs to know which language to present itself itself to you, it's making a bunch of determinations about you based on your data. It's looking at you and going, well, I think they're from this place because of this behavior, and so I will materially affect what they see based on what I think about them. And most of the time we live with that as a kind of necessary side effect of being, you know, of using the web, getting free stuff, this kind of stuff. But it's not just happening to our commercial preferences at all, it happens to our citizenship. And I'll use that that phrase again from Hannah Arendt, citizenship being the right to have rights. When it's your commercial interests that are being affected, it's your maybe what you see or what you buy that's affected. When it's your citizenship that is being determined and changed all the time, then it's your rights that are being affected. And this is the conception of citizenship that, for example, underlies the worldwide NSA, G6Q, and many other agencies' surveillance regime online. So this is an NSA document detailing how they decide what your citizenship is online, which is that they look at the data, look at the various things they know about you, which is not, you know, your name or your real location, merely your behaviours online. And from that they determine your citizenship, and out of that comes your rights, because different agencies have different laws about who they're allowed to surveil. The NSA isn't supposed to surveil American citizens, for example, but if they determine through these various pieces of mathematics that your behaviour online suggests that you're not American, therefore you can be surveilled. This is a direct application of the algorithm to determine your rights. We're all, as I said, inhabiting this border zone now in which these things apply all of the time. So System X, which you had mentioned before, is a browser extension which you can install and which calculates, well, first of all, it does the thing of showing you where in the world you're actually accessing, right? Which is quite a trivial thing, but it's nice. It's nice to look at this this suddenly see manifest the physical infrastructure of the internet, because the internet is real. It's not some magical faraway place. It consists of very large buildings that exist in geographical territory and more specifically within legal jurisdictions. And your data resides and other data resides in places where it has that has meaning and deep politics. But alongside the infrastructure, it builds you over time this algorithmic citizenship that tells you you know, how you might be judged by behaving online and therefore kind of what that might mean to you. Algorithmic system, you heard a lot of talk about algorithms as being in very hand-wavy kind of ways. But I think algorithmic citizenship is a useful term because it's what is significant about this citizenship is not merely that it is being calculated or that it is being, or even that calculation is not visible to you, which is one of the often complaints about algorithms that they're opaque. It's not that this is being calculated or withheld, but the fact that it's changeable. That it's flickering all the time at the speed of data, that your citizenship has become deeply, deeply unstable and can change and have different meanings for you at any particular time. Most of us who are lucky and privileged enough not to have unstable identities, unstable relationships with the state most of the time, is how we feel, it's no longer true. This is our relationship to the state now and to many other kind of entities that have power over us. And algorithmic means specifically that that is subject to change at all times and is unstable. And that is both kind of terrifying, but also I'd like to leaven it as little by saying it's also potentially interesting. It's not just the NSA who are, currently it is just the NSA who are determining your algorithmic citizenship and many other intelligence agencies and actors. But it needn't be. It needn't be only new forms of citizenship which are put forward and enacted by actors who are opaque to us. It can also be potentially invoked by us. If we know that this is going on, if we know that this is the state in which we live, this total, worldwide and ubiquitous border state of exception, then perhaps we can do something about it. Perhaps it may in fact come out to be useful to us. I keep trying to come out with examples of how. And my usual go-to one is current debates over the EU. As someone who moves around the EU frequently, as a British person who's deeply worried my government is going to remove us from the EU, I would like to have some say in other places. I would like other people to have some say in Britain's decision. I think the Greek people might be interested in having a wider referendum on Greece's politics than simply the people who happen to reside in Greece or have Greek citizenship right now. And perhaps, and this is probably a terrible idea, but it might be an interesting one, concepts like algorithmic citizenship, when they are open, when they are available to all of us, might actually become useful in that way. We don't have to reject the inventions of the secret state or the deep state out of hand. We can also perhaps learn from and from the technologies, because all the technologies are our own desires unconsciously displayed somewhere. The thing is, I think we can see these models for what new forms of citizenship and thus new relationships with the state or even post-state new relationships with the world and each other being built up in all of our technologies. We constantly produce these new ways of living in the world, but largely shut ourselves out from them. But goods, for example, live in this world already, right? The free transport of goods is what underlies a bunch of our kind of political relationships and relationships with the world. Logistics space being an example of where the state is completely and utterly interpenetrated by these different flows of trade, and where goods and services are not produced any longer in one particular location, but are produced across a whole chain of places that are constituted through travel networks and factories and so on and so forth. And we know this every time we order something online and we watch these signals ping around and we watch the goods be transported and we know that they've been assembled in multiple places. That forms a model of not just of politics and kind of geopolitics, but of identity itself. It's something that is becoming in the world that perhaps we could attach ourselves to. Likewise, my background's in publishing and books. And for years I've been writing about books and e-books in this way. And there's nothing very interesting about books when they become electronic. There's nothing very interesting about taking a text and putting it on a screen in and of itself. What has changed is its relationship to everything else. It's what we call its place values. The fact that the text immediately stops becoming about what it is in itself and becomes its relationship to other stories and other texts. And again, we know this because we spend a lot of time online. And we know that hyperlinks and clicks are ways of bringing all of that information together. Those two are models for that we have produced, that we are already living, that would actually account for some of the problems and the things that we're discussing. I don't think what I'm talking about will be achieved by some kind of hope or irredentism, essentially, for the internet. Some kind of golden age of what the internet used to be in terms of a kind of golden age of social interaction. We hear a lot about the web we have lost, or the ideas of the internet that haven't kind of come through in the way in which it's been kind of captured by social or market forces. But I think within those things, we can find kind of some of these models for perhaps how we should be taking this one. But along the way, we need to build things. We need to make objects. We need to have texts. We need to kind of bring new discussions into the I am rambling now. I had my point here, and I'm going to go back to it. These things, these objects, these texts, these behaviors, they're mediations between us and between machines, between us and states. We can take one of these concepts, one of these things, citizenship, which is essentially the software we've run atop the hardware of the nation state for the last 100 years or so, and we can look at ways in which we can rewrite it, and build new tools that will define us for the next 10 years. I'm going to stop there. Thank you very much.
My name is Karis. Hi, James. I'm wondering about, so I've been following your work for a while, and in my work, I'm in games and making games about social issues, and so the nature of games is that people participate, they interact, and the things I make are about similar things that your work is about systems. And in my, to me, systems are about kind of, to understand systems, you need kind of that interactivity to kind of grasp what systems do and how they affect you. And it strikes me in your work, however much I love it, is that that aspect, interactivity, participation, is quite limited. Is that a personal choice? Is that an accident? Is that a strategic choice? Can you talk about that a little bit more?
Yeah, absolutely. In part, it's because I've never figured out how to do it. I have huge respect for kind of more interactive works. And I've sort of occasionally I've attempted to do them before and don't feel I have the skill set to kind of to do that, essentially. I think it's one of the most powerful ways of kind of getting into the way of course, not least because it's the way I've learned to do the things that I do. And it's probably a part of why I feel some of the frustration with the limits of just showing, which I've talked about before. While I can stand up on stage and be very didactic to an audience, I'm also a little bit scared of trying to direct the experience that people have with the work so strongly. Like, I have very strong feelings about what these things that I do mean for me, and I'll happily tell everyone about it. But I also want to leave a huge part of that open. But I don't have a good reason for not doing it, apart from not thinking I'm very good at it. I think it's just about like approaching different ways of kind of coming to these forms of literacy, because I think there's if there's something in common between the two approaches, it's as you said, this kind of trying to develop some kind of literacy in this stuff which you can pass on, and you can pass that on through kind of learning, kind of education stuff, or you can, as I do, I think maybe more so, just try and kind of demonstrate it in what you do, essentially, which is probably why I more position myself, which might be a slightly more kind of selfish position, essentially. But it's how I think and how my thought process goes, that I will kind of go off down this research and these things will fall out, and then I will tell people about them. But the pedagogical thing. So I learned that from learning to code. That was my kind of education in systems. And so I think maybe that by demonstrating the skills the tools that I use to make this kind of work encourages other people to pick up those tools as well.
Okay, can I ask something, Malay? When this question would have been posed to you, it would have been your answer, because it seems to me that the Bach is really trying to act, also to intervene.
I have this strange situation that what we do doesn't really belong to any discipline. And I have been discussing this with people from the art policies, that they don't know is this art? When you collaborate with people and some of the work is invisible. And then I found, luckily, an art category called relational aesthetics. So I thought maybe your new aesthetics and relational aesthetics could maybe be friends. Because a relational aesthetics is that your work is not so much visible. It's not something, not an artifact that you can hang on the wall or put it on stage, but it's actually the society itself, the world itself is the canvas. So your intervention is in the relation. So it's sometimes it's invisible. So if you create another hardware or another software or another way of interaction, that might, you can't point to the code, but it's not something that normally would be considered artwork. So I think what we do is will always be about bringing people in a new position and bringing people together. So it's always a platform where people can engage. But I must say, I'm very impressed by the work, and I'm very happy that not everybody's doing that, because I think the way, if you put this plane on the floor, on this square, in that enables so many people to talk about it. So it's, to me, that's as much engaging. But I think the strategy is different.
So where James makes the invisible visible, you try to design a platform for action, for open.
Yeah, for example, the Biohack Academy enables a lot of people to build their own bio lab, or bio lab. So we would always, what we do is always downloadable, repeatable, scalable, open. So we would always look for something that can be, other people can take it in their own hands and do it.
Thanks. Other comments, questions there? You have already had it, so are there more questions? Yeah. Name and question.
Hi, my name is Tanya Schep. I'm the creative lead at the Setup Media Lab here in Utrecht. I was wondering how you both seem to have a relationship to the government, right? Like Marlene has this idea of citizenship and how we as citizens have to understand technology. Well, in your work, I see mostly not a fear, that's not the right word, but a mistrust, perhaps, of government. So you both seem to have like different sides of a coin in a way. I was wondering if you could talk about that, or how you feel about that, and what the role of government would be in this situation. Like in my idea, I would love it for the government to actually understand this stuff better and have a more nurturing and a warm role in all this, but that, I know that might be very difficult.
Well, I think it's a very problematic relationship by nature, because, but I would like to make a division between the people that work in or for government and the government. Because if I talk to people, there are a lot of people that want to change. They want to, they're professionals, but they see also the limits of how government work, and they want to rethink if it's open data or like the people that we work with on the identity. They see that there could be another way of working, and it could be another way of how government would operate. But if you look at the structure of government and the way it operates, I think there are a lot of limitations, and I have to make myself optimistic again and again to engage. So it's not about the people, but about how processes. And I'm afraid that look at the ICT projects of the Netherlands. Well, that happens in the UK as well. Everything goes wrong. They're totally they're captured in the relationship with big companies that have the key to all the software, because it's all closed technologies. And the only way to get out of it is to say we make open technologies. But I don't see it happen now. And the only this commission alias, and then the only solution is more process, not fundamental in what they should do. So I don't know. I think we can. We now think about this idea of a beta lab, that everything that the government wants to do with ICT first has to go through this design process. And when everybody, when we have the civic vision on this technology, then maybe they can implement it.
I just always end up with government as the thing that I'm yelling at, basically. When I was doing all of the work on drones, who do you end up yelling at about that? Like, you end up yelling at the US government. And one of the reasons I tried to stop doing so much stuff about drones is that I'm not a US citizen, and therefore you can yell at the US government all you like, but they really don't care. So I started kind of looking at things that were closer, that I was interested in the UK, but the issues that I'm interested in always come back to whether it's stuff around surveillance or citizenship or these kind of issues that are issues I've come to that are not necessarily obviously technological, but I end up kind of hitting them because of my interest through technology. They always bump into government as well. So yeah, until like something is restructured in quite a more fundamental way, if you're angry, the government is kind of always where you're going to end up yelling. It doesn't, you know, the reason you do the yelling is you hope it doesn't always have to be that way, and there's different kind of structures for it. But we haven't yet seemed to work out some kind of model that means that isn't the kind of last centre of appeal. And actually, if you know, for me, if you care about the state of the world, you're always going to end up kind of pointing fingers towards the most powerful entity, because it's the power that, you know, that might, in a better world, actually be able to affect this stuff.
Okay, there's time for a last question. Who wants to pose it? If nobody raises his hand, I've got the end. I would have gone to the... It's not this evening, I'm sorry.
My name is Mary Angela, and I have a question, and it feels like the more knowledge I gain, the more insecure I get. And for instance, the question, like, while I'm listening to you, I'm checking my iPhone to see what's happening in Hungary, and trying to listen and to do everything at the same time. And one of the things I hear, for instance, now is that I have this complete aversion when I think of Facebook, and in the meantime, it enables me to meet other people, to create a crowd, and to actually organize things. So maybe my question is more about addiction, because I'm not really good at doing a little bit of something. I can quit something or I can do it completely. And the question with you is, like, how do you deal with that? So feeling on the one hand that it's helping you, and on the other hand that it's something that you might, that might be repulsive in a certain way.
Last question.
Let's move on to the first part as maybe a way of answering the second, is how I see it. That feeling of being overwhelmed and like too much information and like too much going on, like that has always been the case. That is not new in history that we have felt that. You can look back to the literatures of all like civilization. For every society we have a record of, people are like, oh, everything's speeding up, it's moving too fast, it's all of this. And you know what they were doing? They were writing it down because that was the technology they had to express it through at the time. Just as today, the internet seems to stand in for our feelings that everything is kind of speeding up and accelerating all this thing. And my feeling about that is that it doesn't, well, new technologies rarely engender sort of ex nihilo, entirely new forms of behavior. Rather, they show us so much more clearly the way we've always felt about these things, and kind of demonstrate them to us and draw them out in these exceptionally clear ways. Because we created the technologies to do that. That's what they're for. They're ever increasingly better models of the world that we already inhabit. And that addiction, that backwards and forwards feeling, for me is one of those things. We are drawn to these things because we know they contain all of this potential. And we also know that they can also be confusing and excessive and damaging in all these kind of ways. But that's always been the push and pull of these new things. And so the battle we're fighting is not really whether they're good or bad, or because, as we know very well, technology is never good or bad or neutral. It's simply how we attempt to address and explore in our own time. It is a constant process of coming to terms with those feelings. There's no wrong way to feel about them, essentially. But the job, therefore, is to learn constantly how to deal with them and to recognise that it just is that complicated.
Last one from the name.
I think you really should liberate yourself. because what to me is very strange is that people that are very aware of bio-industry, they don't want to hurt animals, they don't want to, they're thinking about equal clothes and fair coffee and fair trade. But when it comes to social media, they lose everything, they think everything is okay. But actually, you're empowering using, and maybe, I mean, there are a lot of bad boys, bad guys there, but Mark Zuckerberg is really, really a terrible person, and he has really no good intentions with you at all. You are in a bad relationship, and you should liberate yourself from it. You will feel so good after that. And then you can figure out other, there are alternatives. I chose not to immerse myself again immediately, so, but there are some good alternatives. There are people that make, and I think you really have to question yourself the morality. What is the morale of this technology, of this service? And if you think these people have the wrong intentions, leave it. Go away. Find your friends in another social media. Really, I mean, I think we should take the stand. Why should all these very smart people use a technologies that are evil? Evil intentions. I mean, not understand that it works for you, but that's the problem, that's your addiction. And some of your good friends will find you. I was very happy that some people, they just text me or they send an email and I see them. And don't lose all these people. This is what I was afraid for myself. But good friends will stick with you. And there are other social media that can help people to organize themselves. Anyway, that's my. I think in 5 years' time, if people say, "What are you using this sort of like unfriendly media?" You will understand. I think we're only starting to understand that technology is not neutral. It's only the beginning of this language, that we find language. And I think your type of projects helps us to see through the impact of algorithms in our daily lives.
Can so. I just react to that?
Well, no, I don't think I want that. I think it's time to wrap up. It's in a long
Let's have a drink.
You can try, but I have the mic. I have the technology. No, I don't think you can. I think I don't really want to.
Why is an alternative LO? Like, that makes no sense to me. You just suggest exactly the same thing, but from a person that is maybe not that known yet.
So I love suggesting LO because I also think they are driven by shareholders' value. I think this, yes. You have to look at the business model.
That was exactly in your alternative plan of.
Well, LO, the LO is was at that moment one of those question marks. I wouldn't go for LO because they're on the same business model. I think everything which is on the business model of exploiting data is wrong. We should leave it aside. So there are some, I'm not going to proclaim others because I think there are some that don't, Heartbeat wants to do it. There are some initiatives that go the other way based on other business models. But check the business model, that would be very important.
Okay, thank you.